The seventh topic, the fruit of a Friday in Denizli prison. In the name of God, the merciful, the compassionate, the comments of the hour of resurrection will be like the glance of an eye or believer. The creation of you all and the resurrection of you all is but like that of a single soul. So look to the signs of God's mercy, how he gives life to the earth after its death. He, it is who will raise the dead to life, and he is powerful over all things. The prisoners in Denizli prison who were able to have contact with me read the lesson in the sixth topic I had at one time given in the tongues of the sciences to the high school pupils in Kastamonu. For they had asked me, tell us about our creature, and having acquired a firm belief, they felt a longing for the hereafter. They accused it of me, teach us also about the hereafter, so that we won't be led astray by our souls and the Satans of these times, and they will not again be the cause of our being sent to prison. In the face of this request of the Risale-i Nur students in the prison and the readers of the sixth topic need arose for an explanatory summary of the pillar of belief in the hereafter as well, and I offered them a brief summary of various passages from the Risale-i Nur. In the sixth topic, we asked the heavens and the earth about our creature, and they described him to us as clearly as the sun in the tongues of the sciences. Now, in the same way, we shall ask firstly our sustainer, whom we have learned about the hereafter, then our prophet, then the Quran, then the other prophets and holy scriptures, then the angels, and then the universe. In the first stage, we ask God about the hereafter. He replies through all the envoys he has sent, and his decrees, and all his names and attributes. Yes, the hereafter exists, and I shall send you there. The tenth word has prompted and elucidated with 12 brilliant, decisive truths the answers about the hereafter of a number of names. Deeming those explanations to be sufficient, here we shall point them out briefly. Yes, there is no holder of sovereignty that does not reward those who obey him and punish the rebellious. So, when the holder of an eternal sovereignty, which is at the degree of absolute dominicality, rewards those who form a relation with him through belief and submit to his decrees, and punishes rebellious disbelievers who deny his proud sovereignty, it will be in a manner befitting his mercy and beauty, his dignity and glory. Thus, the names sustainer of all the worlds and just monarch reply to our question. Also, we see on the face of the earth, as clearly as the sun, as daylight, a general mercy and all-embracing compassion and munificence. For example, every spring that mercy adorns all the fruit-bearing trees and plants like houris, it fills their hands with every sort of fruit, and they hold them out to us, saying, help yourselves and eat. It also gives us sweet, healing honey to eat from the poisonous bee, and dresses us in the softest silk by means of a handless insect. It deposits for us in a handful of tiny seeds points of food, making those tiny stores into reserve supplies. Such a mercy and compassion surely would not execute these lovable, grateful, worshipping believers which they nurture so kindly. Indeed, they dismiss them from their duties in this worldly life to bestow on them still more brilliant instances of mercy, and in so doing the names of all compassionate and munificence answer our question. Also, we see before our eyes that a hand of wisdom works in all creatures on the face of the earth, and a justice is enforced with its measures, nothing superior to which the human mind can conceive of. For example, a pure eternal wisdom inscribes in man's faculty of memory, which is one instance of wisdom in his thousands of faculties and physical systems, and is as tiny as a minuscule seed, his entire life story and the numerous events which touch on him, making it into a small library. He then places it in the pocket of his mind as a note from the register of his actions, which will be published for his judgment at the great gathering, in order to continuously remind him of this. And an eternal justice places on all creatures their members with the finest balance, and makes all of them, from the microbe to the rhinoceros, and the fly to the Simurgh bird, and from a flowering plant to the flower of the spring, which opens thousands of millions of flowers in the spring, with a beauty of art and balance with no waste, within a mutual proportion, equilibrium, order, and beauty, it gives all living creatures their rights of life with perfect balance, and makes good things produce good results, and bad things bad results. And since the time of Adam, it has made itself felt forcefully through the blows it has dealt to rebellious and tyrannous peoples. Certainly, and without doubt, just as the sun cannot be without the day, so that pure eternal wisdom and eternal justice cannot be without the hereafter. The names of all wise and sapient, just and equitable would never permit the awesome injustice, inequity, and unwisdom of oppressed and oppressor being equal in death, and thus they decisively answer our question. Also, since whenever living creatures seek their natural wishes, which are beyond their power, through the tongues of their innate abilities and essential needs, which is supplication of a sort, all their needs are given to them by a most compassionate, hearing, kind unseen hand, and since 6 or 7 out of 10 of human supplications, which are voluntary, especially those of the prophets and the elect, are accepted in a way contrary to the normal course of things, it is understood certainly that behind the veil of the unseen is one who listens and hears the sighs of the suffering and prayers of the needy, and replies to them. He sees the least need of the smallest living being, and compassionately replying by action, gratifies it. There is no possibility of doubting, therefore, that the one who includes in his supplication all the most important general supplications of man, the most important of creatures, which are connected with all the divine names and attributes, and are for immortality, and takes behind him all the other prophets, who are the suns, stars, and leaders of mankind, making them exclaim, Amin, Amin, and for whom benedictions are recited several times every day, and to whose supplication all the members of his community rejoin, Amin, Amin. Indeed, in whose supplication all creatures take part, saying, Yes, O Lord, do give what he asks. We too want what he seeks. Of all the causes necessitating resurrection under these irresistible conditions, only a single supplication of Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, for immortality in the hereafter and eternal happiness, would have been sufficient reason for the existence of paradise and creation of the hereafter, which are as easy for divine power as the creation of the spring. Stating this, the names of answerer of prayer, all hearing and all compassionate, answer our question. Also, since as clearly as the sun is shown by daylight, behind the veil is one who has disposal over the universal death and revivification in the alternation of the seasons on the earth, and a pen of power inscribes the mighty globe with the ease and orderliness of a garden or even a tree, and the splendid spring with the facility and symmetrical adornments of a flower, and the species of plants and animals, as though they were 300,000 books displaying 300,000 samples of resurrection, all one within the other, and intermingled, and mixed up together, yet without disarrangements or disorder, all resembling each other, yet without confusion, error, or fault, perfectly, regularly, and meaningfully. And since, despite this vast profusion that one works with boundless mercy and infinite wisdom, and since he has subjugated, decorated, and furnished the vast universe for man like a house, and appointing him vicegerent of the earth, committing to him the sovereign trust, from the bearing of which the mountains, sky, and earth shrank, and has raised him to the rank of commanding officer over other living beings, honored him with a divine address and conversation, and since he has thus bestowed on man this circumstation, and in all the revealed decrees promised him eternal happiness and immortal life in the hereafter, certainly and without doubt he will open up that realm of bliss for ennobled and honored man, which is as easy for his power as the spring, and bring about the resurrection of the dead and last judgment. Stating this, the names of granter of life and dealer of death, ever living and self-substant and all-powerful and loving, replied to the question we asked of our creature. Yes, if one considers the power which ever spring raises to life identically the roots of all the trees and plants, and creates the 300,000 plants and animal samples of the resurrection of the dead, and if one visualizes the 1,000-year period of each of the communities of Moses and Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon them, and they are pictured in the imagination, it will be seen that the 2,000 springs display 1,000 samples of resurrection and 1,000 evidences. Note, it is as though doomsday has occurred in all past springs and they have died, and the following springs have been their resurrections. One would have to be blind and unreasonable 1,000 times over to consider bodily resurrection difficult for such a power. Also, just as relying on Almighty God's thousands of promises, the 24,000 prophets, who are the most renowned of mankind, have unanimously proclaimed and proved through their miracles that eternal happiness and immortality in the hereafter are true, so innumerable people of sainthood have put their signature to the same truth through their illuminations and unfoldings. Since this is so, surely this truth is as clear as the sun, and those who doubt it are crazy. Yes, the ideas and judgments of one or two experts in a science or art concerning their science refute the opposing ideas of 10 men who are not experts in it, even if they are experts in their own fields. Similarly, two people making a positive statement about a subject, for example, proving the crescent moon of Ramadan on the day it is uncertain, or claiming there is a garden on the earth where coconuts resembling cans of milk are grown, defeat 1,000 deniers and win the case. For the one making the positive statement has only to point out the place where the coconuts are found to easily win. Whereas the one who denies it can prove his case only by searching the whole face of the earth and demonstrating that the coconuts are not to be found anywhere. So, one who makes a report of paradise and the realm of bliss and asserts that they exist wins his case by only demonstrating through illumination a shadow or distillation of it, like in the cinema, while those who deny it can only win by proving their denial by seeing the whole universe and all time from pure eternity to post-eternity and demonstrating it. It is because of this that the investigative scholars have agreed on the rule, on condition they are not inherently impossible, denials which are not specific but look to the whole universe like the truths of belief cannot be proved, and have accepted it as a fundamental principle. In consequence of this definite truth, while the opposing ideas of thousands of philosophers should not cast the slightest doubt or even suspicion on even a single truthful report concerning questions of belief, you can understand what a lunacy it is to fall into doubt at the denials of a handful of philosophers who concerning the pillars of belief understand no further than their eyes see, have no heart, are blind, and have grown distant from spiritual matters. For the pillars of faith have been agreed upon by 120,000 experts, scholars, and truthful reporters with their positive assertions, and innumerable specialists in the fields of reality and investigative scholars. Also, we see with our own eyes as clearly as daylight both in ourselves and all around us a comprehensive mercy and all-embracing wisdom and constant bestowal of grace. We observe too the traces and manifestations of an awesome sovereignty of domiciliary, a precise and lofty justice, and a proud and glorious garment. Indeed, the wisdom which attaches intensities of wisdom to a tree, to the number of its fruits and flowers, and the mercy which bestows bounties and favors on every human being to the number of his faculties, members, and feelings, and the proud, yet gracious justice which deals blows at rebellious peoples like those of Nah, Hud, and Salih, peace be upon them, and the Ad, Thamud, and people of Wara, and protects the rights of the least living being and the birds. And among his signs is this, that heaven and earth stand by his command. Then, when he calls you by a single call from the earth, behold, you straightway come forth. All state the following with a majestic conciseness. Just as at the summons of their commander and the sound of the bugle, the disciplined soldiers stationed in two barracks spring to arms and their duties, so whenever the bugle call of Israfil, peace be upon him, summons those lying in death in the vast heavens and in the earth, which are like two orderly barracks for the soldiers of the pure eternal monarch, obedient to his command, they will immediately don the uniforms of their bodies and rise up. Proving and demonstrating this is the same situation displayed by the beings in the barracks of the earth in the spring at the trumpet blast of the angel of thunder, and from it is understood the infinite grandeur of the sovereign of dominicality. As is proud in the tenth word, it is certainly therefore utterly impossible that the realm of the hereafter, an arena of the resurrection and great gathering, which are most definitely demanded by that mercy, wisdom, grace, and justice, should not be inaugurated, and for that infinitely beautiful mercy to be transformed into ugly cruelty, and for that boundless perfection of wisdom to be turned into infinitely faulty futility and purposeless wastefulness, and that sweet grace to be transformed into bitter treachery, and that finally balanced and equitable justice to be turned into severe tyranny, and that utterly powerful and majestic eternal sovereignty to decline, and with the resurrection not occurring for it to lose all its splendor, and for the perfections of its dominicality to be marred by impotence and defect. This would be completely unreasonable and a compounded impossibility outside the bounds of possibility and false and precluded. For all those with intelligence would surely understand what a cruel unkindness it would be, having nurtured man so solicitously and given him true faculties like the heart and intellect, a sense of longing for eternal happiness and everlasting life in the hereafter, to dispatch him to eternal non-being, and how contrary to wisdom it would be, having attached hundreds of purposes and instances of wisdom to only his brain, to waste through endless death all his faculties and his abilities with their thousands of purposes, thus making them devoid of all use, purpose, and result, and how utterly opposed to the splendor of that sovereignty and perfect dominicality it would be, by not carrying out his thousands of promises to demonstrate, God forbid, his impotence and ignorance. You may make an analogy with this for grace and justice. Thus, the names of most merciful, all just, all wise, munificent, and ruler answer with the above truths the question we asked our creature about the hereafter and prove it as indubitably and clearly as the sun. Moreover, we observe that prevailing over everything is a vast and comprehensive preservation which records in their seats, on the tablets of the world of similitudes, in their memories, which are tiny samples of the preserved tablet, and particularly in the faculty of memory, which is a tiny library in man's brain, which is at the same time very large, and in other mirrors, physical and non-physical, in which they are reflected, the numerous forms of all living creatures and all things, and the notebooks of the duties they perform in accordance with their essential natures, and the pages of their deeds pertaining to the glorifications they perform towards the divine names through the tongues of their beings, it inscribes them in this and records and preserves them. Then, when the time comes, every spring, which is a flower of divine power, they display to us all those immaterial inscriptions in physical form, proclaimed to the universe with millions of tongues, within that sovereign flower, and with the strength of millions of examples, evidences, and samples, the wondrous truth of resurrection expressed in the verse. When the pages are spread out, it proves most cogently that foremost man and all living beings and all things were created not to topple over into nothingness, to fall into non-existence, to be annihilated, but to win immortality through progressing and permanence through being purified, and to take up the eternal duties required by their innate capacities. Yes, we observe every spring that the innumerable plants which die in the doomsday of the autumn, and all the trees, roots, seeds, and grains in the resurrection of the spring recite the verse, when the pages are spread out, expounding each in its own tongue one meaning of the verse, one facet of it, with examples of the duties it performed in previous years, they all testify to that vast preservation. They display in everything the four vast truths of the verse. He is the first and the last, the evident and the inward, and instruct us with the ease and certainty of the spring. The manifestations of these four names occur in all things from the most particular to the most universal. For example, through manifesting the name of first, a seed, the source of a tree, is a precise program of it and a small receptacle containing the faultless systems of the tree's creation and all the conditions of its formation, thus proving the vastness of divine preservation. Then, together with the tree's seeds, its fruit manifests the name of last. They are coffers containing the indexes of all the duties the tree has performed in accordance with its nature and the principles of its second life, thus testifying at a maximum level to divine preservation. The tree's physical form, which manifests the name of evidence, is a finely proportioned, skillfully decorated garment. Like a 70-hued robe of the Huris, which has been embroidered with gilded motifs, it demonstrates visibly the vast power, perfect wisdom, and beautiful mercy within divine preservation. As for the machinery within the tree, which manifests the name of Immort, it is a regular, miraculous, faultless factory and workbench, a balanced cauldron of food which leaves unnourished none of its branches, fruits, or leaves, thus proving as brilliantly as the sun the perfect power, justice, and beautiful mercy and wisdom within divine preservation. Similarly, in respect of the annual seasons, the globe is a tree. Through the manifestation of the name of first, all the seeds and grains entrusted to divine preservation in the season of autumn are small collections of the divine comments concerning the formation of the tree of the face of the earth, which, when it is enwrapped in the garment of spring, puts forth millions of branches and twigs and fruits and flowers. So too, those seeds are list of the principles proceeding from divine determining, and the tiny pages of the tree's deeds of the previous summer, and the notebooks of its tasks, which demonstrate self-evidently that they function through the infinite power, justice, wisdom, and mercy of a glorious and magnificent preserver. Then, the end of the annual tree of the earth is, in the second autumn, its depositing in those tiny containers all the duties it has performed, all the glorifications it has recited before the divine names in accordance with its creation, and all the pages of its deeds that it will publish the following resurrection of spring, its handing them over to the hands of wisdom of the glorious preserver, and reciting the name of He is the last before the whole universe in innumerable tongues. The evident face of the tree is, by its opening 300,000 universal source of blossoms, which demonstrate 300,000 examples and signs of the resurrection of the dead, and its spreading out innumerable tables of mercifulness, providence, compassionateness, and munificence, and its offering banquets to living beings, its reciting the name of He is the evident, with tongues to the number of its fruits, flowers, and foods, and offering praise and laudation, and showing as clearly as daylight the truth of when the pages are spread out. The inner face of this majestic tree is a cauldron and workbench running precisely and in orderly fashion incalculable numbers of regular machines and finely balanced factories which cook thousands of pounds of food out of one once and offer it to the hungry. It works with such precision and balance that it leaves no room for chance to interfere. Like some angels who glorify God with a thousand tongues, with the inner face of the earth, it proclaims the name of He is the Immortal in 100,000 ways and proves it. Just as in respect of its annual life, the earth is a tree and makes the divine preservation within those four names a key to the door of resurrection, so in respect of its world life, it is again a well-ordered tree whose fruits are sent to the market of hereafter. It is a place of manifestation of those four names and mirror to them so broad and road leading to the hereafter so lengthy, our minds are incapable of comprehending and describing it, we can only say this much. As the hands of a weekly clock, which count the seconds, minutes, hours, and days, resemble each other and prove each other, and one who sees the movement of the second hand is bound to assent to the movement of the others, so the days, which count the seconds of this world, which is a vast clock of the glorious creature of the heavens and earth, and the years, which count its minutes, and the centuries, which show its hours, and the ages, which make known its days, all resemble and prove each other. So too, the name of Preserver and those of He is the first and the last, the evident and the inward, inform us through innumerable signs that as certainly as the morning of this night will come and this winter's spring, so will the everlasting spring and eternal morning come of the dark winter of this transitory world. Thus, answering with the above truths the question of resurrection concerning which we asked our Creator. Also, since we see with our eyes and understand with our minds that man is the final and most comprehensive fruit of the tree of the universe, and in respect of the Muhammadan, peace and blessings be upon him, reality is its original seed, and the supreme sign of the Quran of the universe, and he is its drawn verse bearing the greatest name, and the most honored guest in the palace of the universe, the most active functionary empowered over the other inhabitants of the palace, the official charged with overseeing the income and expenditure and the planting and cultivation of the gardens in the corridor of the earth in the city of the universe, and is its most noisy and responsible minister, equipped with hundreds of sciences and thousands of arts, and an inspector and sort of vicegerent of the monarch of pure eternity and post-eternity, under his close scrutiny, in the region of the earth, in the country of the universe, and one with disposal over it whose actions, particular and universal, are all recorded, who has undertaken the certain trust from which the heavens and earth and mountains shrank, and before whom are two rods, on one of which he is the most wretched of living beings, and on the other the most fortunate, and he is a universal bondsman charged with most extensive worship, the place of manifestation of the greatest name of the monarch of the universe, and a comprehensive mirror of all his names, a special addressee of his with the best understanding of his divine addresses and speech, the most needy of the living beings of the universe, and is a wretched living creature who has innumerable desires and goals, numberless enemies and things that harm him, despite his infinite poverty and impotence, is the richest in regard to abilities and potentialities, the most suffering in respect of the pleasures of life, whose enjoyment is marred by ghastly pains, and a wondrous miracle of the power of the Eternal Besought One, and marvel of divine power, who is the most needy and wanting and worthy and deserving of immortality, and seeks and beseeches eternal happiness with endless prayers, And if all the pleasures of this world were given him, his desire for immortality would not be satisfied. And who loves to the degree of worshipping him, the one who bestows bounties on him, and makes him loved, and is loved, and all of whose faculties, which encompass the universe, testify that he was created to go to eternity, and through the above 20 universal truths is bound to Almighty God's name of truth, and whose actions are continuously recorded by the all-glorious preserver's name of preserver, who sees the most insignificant need of the tiniest animate being, hears it plaint and responds in action, and being related to the whole universe, whose deeds are written down by the noble scribes of that name, and who more than anything else receives its attention. As required by the above 20 truths, most certainly and without any doubt, there will be a resurrection and judgment for man, and in accordance with the name of truth, he will receive reward for his above duties and punishment for his faults, and in accordance with the name of preserver, he will be questioned and called to account for his actions, all of which have been recorded, and the doors will be opened of the feasting halls of everlasting bliss in the eternal realm, and of the prison of eternal misery. Man, who has been an officer with command over numerous species of beings in this world, and has intervened in them, and sometimes thrown them into confusion, will not enter the soil, never to be questioned concerning his actions, nor lay down in concealment, not to be roused. For to hear the buzz of the fly, and to answer it actively by giving it its rights of life, and not to hear the prayers for eternity made through the tongues of the above 20 truths of innumerable human rights, which reverberate through the heavens and earth like thunder, and to transgress all those rights, and for a wisdom which, as is testified to by the order of the fly's wing, wastes not even such a wing, to waste utterly man's abilities, which are bound by those truths, and his hopes and desires, which reach out to eternity, and the many bounds and truths of the universe which nourish those abilities and desires, would be such an injustice, and so impossible, and such a tyrannical ugliness, that all beings which testify to the names of truth, preserver, all wise, all beauteous, and all compassionate reject it, declaring it to be utterly impossible and precluded. Thus, in reply to our question to our creature about resurrection, the names of truth, preserver, all wise, all beauteous, and all compassionate say, just as we are truth and reality, and the beings that testify to us are true, so the resurrection of the dead is true and certain. And since I was going to write more, but since the above is as clear as the sun, I have curtailed the discussion. Thus, making an analogy with the matters in the above examples and senses, through their manifestations and reflections in beings, all Almighty God's hundreds, indeed a thousand, names which look to the universe prove self-evidently the one they signify, so too do they demonstrate the resurrection of the dead and hereafter, and prove them definitively. Also, just as through all his decrees and the scriptures he has revealed, and most of his names by which he is described, our sustainer gives us sacred and decisive answers to the question we asked our creature, so he causes it to be answered through his angels, and in another fashion through their tongue. There have been hundreds of incidents unanimously attested to since the time of Adam, of your meeting both with spirit beings and with us, and there are innumerable signs and evidences of our existence and worship and that of the spirit beings. In agreement with each other, we have told your leaders when we have met with them that we travel through the halls of the hereafter and in some of its apartments, and we always say this. We have no doubt that the fine, eternal halls that we have wandered through, and the well-appointed decorated palaces and dwellings beyond them await important guests in order to accommodate them. We give you certain news of this. They reply to our question thus. Also, since our creature appointed Muhammad the Arabian peace and blessings be upon him as the greatest teacher, best master, and truest guide, who is neither confused nor confuses, and sent him as his last envoy before anything in order to progress and advance from the degree of knowledge of certainty to those of vision of certainty and absolute certainty, we should ask this master the question we asked of our creature. For just as that being, through his 1,000 miracles, which were a mark of our creature's confirmation, and as a miracle of the Quran, proved that the Quran is true and God's word, so through its 40 aspects of miraculousness, as a miracle of his, the Quran proves that he was true and God's messenger. The reality of resurrection which they prove won the tongue of the manifest world, claimed it throughout his life, confirmed by all the prophets and saints, and the other, the tongue of the world of the unseen, claims it with thousands of its verses, confirmed by all the revealed scriptures and truths of the universe, is as certain as the sun and daylight. Yes, a question like resurrection, which is the most strange and awesome matter and beyond the reason, could only be solved through the instruction of two such wondrous masters and understood. The reason the early prophets did not explain resurrection in detail like the Quran was that at that time mankind was still at a primitive stage of nomadism. There is little detailed explanation in preliminary instruction. And since the angels inform us that they have seen the hereafter and the dwellings of the eternal realm, evidences testifying to the existence and worship of the angels, spirits, and spirit beings are also indirect evidence for the existence of the hereafter. And since, after divine unity, the thing Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, most constantly claimed and asserted throughout his life was the hereafter, certainly all his miracles and proofs which point to his messengership and veracity in one way testify indirectly to the existence of the hereafter and that it will come. And since one quarter of the Quran is about resurrection and the hereafter, and it tries to prove it with thousands of its verses and gives news of it, all the proofs and evidences of the Quran's veracity prove indirectly the existence of the hereafter and its being thrown open. Now, see how firm and certain is this pillar of belief.